presented by Caltech.
All right, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our second annual Teach Week at Caltech. This is a campus-wide celebration of teaching and learning with an incredibly deep participation by our whole campus community. The faculty, our graduate students, our postdocs, some of our undergraduates, our alumni, and friends of Caltech are all here this week. And I shouldn't forget to introduce myself. My name is Cassandra Horii. I'm director of the Center for Teaching, Learning, and Outreach. The CTLO has been around since 2012, and we really started to support all of Caltech's educational efforts. So we work with the K-12 schools, we work on undergraduate and graduate education, and really how all of those things intersect at Caltech as well. This year, the theme of Teach Week is empowering learning, which really highlights the underlying reason that our faculty and our teaching assistants and many of our staff and others really focus on and give their time to teaching and learning. It's not for its own sake, but it's really to help our students go even further with their passions and interests and curiosity and creativity. So this week, you'll get us kind of a broad overview through all of the events and open classes of how we are at Caltech empowering learning today, and some of the ways that we're thinking about doing that for the future as well. That brings us to an important theme in Teach Week, as kind of a sub-theme. So as we think about celebrating teaching, I think we need to recognize that teaching is a work in progress. And indeed, when I've spoken with educators both here at Caltech and nationally over the past many years, I think the common theme among them is really that they rarely believe that they're finished learning how to teach. And in fact, Caltech is also in that process of learning, which I think is both important and really exciting for us as an institution. So that brings us to today's panel, which we've entitled Empowering Learning Through Teaching at Caltech and Beyond. So each of our speakers today has gone far and above the usual and expected with their work in teaching and learning. Pamela Bjorkman, the Centennial Professor of Biology, has been teaching introductory biology to Tibetan monks in India. Rick Flagan, Irma and Ross McCollum-William H. Corcoran Professor of Chemical Engineering and Environmental Science and Engineering, has been rethinking classroom space and how to do group coding work with students in the context of chemical engineering. Antonio Rangel, Bing Professor of Neuroscience, Behavioral Biology and Economics, is working on launching a new online educational platform and an entirely new research initiative in education. And Gregg Wright, Caltech alumnus, class of 69 in biology, and Professor Emeritus at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln, has been recognizing unsung courage among teachers. Indeed, I think it takes courage to make change happen. And I've certainly heard from faculty and teaching assistants about some of their uncertainty and trepidation when they're changing the ways in which they teach, the spaces in which they teach, and the methods that they use. So I'm especially grateful to all of our panelists for their willingness to go beyond the expected, and I hope that you will enjoy their thoughts as well. We'll begin with Pamela Bjorkman.
Thank you, Cassandra. So I think I'm the reason the title was Caltech and Beyond, because this is beyond what I'm going to be talking about. But I'd like to say that I think that some of the things I'm going to talk about might apply to teaching biology in this case, is what I was teaching to the Tibetan monks. But I think it might apply to teaching Caltech undergrads. And so I hope to make this somewhat clear. So first, I'd like to explain that I don't want to go into a lot of detail about this, but I got involved in teaching science to Tibetan monks in exile who are living in India. So as you may know, India opened up its borders to allow Tibetan monks and monasteries to exist in their country, and the Dalai Lama, who's the spiritual leader of Tibetan Buddhists, actually lives in India. And so there are three large monasteries in southern India that have 3,000 or 4,000 monks apiece, and some Tibetan nuns as well. And these are the equivalent of universities. So I was told they're like the Harvard, Yale, and MIT of Tibetan monasteries. I don't know if they have a Caltech or not, but these are places where the monks spend 23 years earning a degree, which is a, there's no equivalent in the Western world, but it's called a Geshe degree, and they become educated in sort of like a doctor of philosophy way. And so I got in, the Dalai Lama, who's right here, right there, he decided that he really wanted to encourage Tibetan monks to become educated in Western science. And so he's quoted as saying that if science proves something that Tibetan Buddhists believe to be wrong, then Buddhism needs to change. So he's extremely interested in having the monks become educated in a couple of areas right now. And those areas are physics and cosmology and neuroscience and also biology. And so we've been trying to convince, I did this through a program called ETSI, which is the Emory Tibet Science Initiative. So it's done through Emory University. But there are other ways that monks are being taught, but this happens to be the program that I was involved in. Okay, so I went to a monastery in India in May and taught them, and I wanted to share with you some of the things that I learned that I think might be applicable to teaching, maybe even at Caltech. So first of all, to let you know that these are monks. We're hoping that this will be extended to women who are the nuns as well, but right now it's just the monks who are being taught. And they have an interesting way of learning, and the way they learn the things that they need to know, so they spend 4 years learning compassion, for example, so they learn all these things, and it's very hard to understand what exactly they're learning, but they do it through debating. And so in this courtyard here, you see monks, and I couldn't take a picture of all of them, but there were probably 2,000 of them out in this courtyard, and they debate with each other in a one-on-one dialogue. And so I don't know if this you can hear this movie, but they're actually, there's a questioner. And you're not going to understand the language anyway, at least I don't think, so I'm going to talk over it. Okay, so this is the questioner. He's questioning this guy, and he's making these hand motions, and he's trying to make points. And if he believes that, and he does it with his prayer beads, which are hanging down here, and if this guy says something that's illogical, he does a different hand motion, which is like this. And so they have to respond within a couple of seconds. And so when I was teaching these monks, they are amazingly quick on their feet. I should say that all the teaching was done through translators. So what I said had to be translated into Tibetan. But this is just the classroom. So you can see the projector there. I have to say it worked about half the time. So a lot of what I did was on the board. And I was paired with a teacher who, young man who had been involved in teaching monks before. So we did this teaching for 3 hours a day of lectures and then 3 hours a day of laboratory. So I'll tell you a little bit more about the lab stuff in a minute. But so you can see the monks here, there were 110 or so in my class. And so how do you actually, these are men in their 20s and 30s, and they've had a variety of educational experiences, but none of them are exactly what you would expect. So some of them had up to high school math, and some of them didn't. And so this became challenging to present concepts in biology that involved numbers. And it was especially challenging to introduce things in biology that involved chemical formulas. So it took a lot of imagination for figuring out how to do this. So I want to show you that eventually I came up with some methods that I think got them involved and that they were very eager to do. And one of them was that in order to explain to them how DNA, which is the genetic material in all our cells, how that is copied or how it replicates. We had the monks stand up in two lines here and join to each other and then base pair. So if you know anything about the structure of DNA, you'll understand there's base pairing rules. And so each of the monks had a card that identified them as an adenine or a guanine or a cytosine or a thymine. And then they had to base pair with each other, and then they had to divide, and then they had to replicate. So that's what they're doing right here. And then sometimes they would pair incorrectly, which would introduce a mutation, and then they would think that was very funny, and so on. So we found that this worked a lot. You can actually see, if you can see the board here, it was showing them the experiment that they were reproducing. And I have to say that this was actually, so I taught all with the translators. So we'd prepare the slides in advance. I would talk to the translators who could speak English, and then they would translate what we were saying. And at one point, I wanted to explain how people know that DNA is replicated in a so-called semi-conservative way. This is a famous experiment that was actually conducted at Caltech by Meselson and Stahl. It involved different isotopes of DNA that allowed them to show that one old strand pairs with a new one, and so on. Okay, so they did it with either heavy DNA or light DNA. And so I said, how should we distinguish the heavy DNA from, you know, the monks who are heavy DNA from the monks with the light isotope of nitrogen? And he said, oh, just have the fat monks be the heavy DNA. And I said, I don't think we should do that. And he said, no, it's fine. They're just fine with this. So anyway, we tried to do it based on they have either yellow or orange shirts and so on. Okay. But then another thing that we did was, I don't know if you can see this, but we had them go outside and pick out things that were alive versus not alive, because one issue for them is in Buddhist writing from 600 years ago, it was said that plants are not alive. And I think this is useful to them to think this way because they need to eat something. So if you're not going to eat animals because it might be your reincarnated mother, you need to eat something, so you say that plants aren't alive. One of the things we did was to isolate DNA from bananas to show, you know, as part of a way to show them that living organisms all have DNA. And I think this is an example of where, when science has shown that something that Buddhism thinks to be a certain way is actually incorrect, they change it. So they're changing their minds about plants being alive, and that allows you to teach them Mendel's experiments with peas that established genetics. Okay, so if you look at these life trees out here, they were saying what they thought were evolutionary descendants. And interestingly, if you can look at this closely enough, a yeti is on one of them. Okay, I have less than 1 minute. So this is when they isolated DNA. We did this with laundry detergent, water, table salt, coffee filters, and isopropanol. And they isolated DNA from saliva and also from bananas. And this is a monk looking at his DNA. And then I just want to show you now an example of when... Okay, I don't know how to play this movie, but... Okay, here's another example when they are, three monks are coming together as transfer RNA, and they are inside a ribosome, and the monks are now going to get together to carry an amino acid, which is showing, they're kicking out one of the transfer RNAs, and they're joining together, so they're illustrating translation of protein. So they really enjoyed this, and my question is, is there a way we could be involving students in more active forms of learning? Okay, that's it.
Thank you, Pamela. So I know you probably have lots of questions, and in fact, we will have time for questions when we get all our panelists together, but let me invite Rick Flagan up.
I don't have any slides. I'm talking about an experiment that's very much an experiment in progress. I'm a professor of chemical engineering. Over the years, in talking with our undergraduates, I was continuously struck by the fact that when they hit the courses that were requiring them to use computers in doing their calculations and solving problems, they were totally unable to do so. It took an incredible amount of time for them to learn to use the programs that they were expected to know to a level that they could actually solve problems. So they're taking conceptually difficult problems, and on top of that, adding the burden of trying to learn how to use a program called MATLAB, which has a rather archaic syntax to it that makes it a real challenge for students to learn. After watching this for quite a few years, a point came up where we saw an opportunity to slip something into the curriculum, and we added a course taught in chemical engineering that's how to do computations using this tool as chemical engineers. So they're tackling problems that they'll see in their later classes. Students are taking this course as sophomores. So they're working on problems that go way beyond the level of their background at that point in time. I taught it for a couple of years as a lecture course with students doing outside problem sets. I tried to do as many examples in class as possible. In a one-hour class section, that was just impossible. It didn't work. It took too much time to do anything in real time. Just showing code and what it does did not get the message across. So I was searching for a way to make the instruction more meaningful to the students to reach them. And I talked to Cassandra about what I could do. She came and watched the class. And after she observed the class, we sat down together and talked about it, and ultimately tried to do an experiment. Now, this was last year in the last few weeks of the class. I had a standard lecture hall that I was teaching in with theater-style chairs on a sloping surface. We came in with a bunch of little projectors that we could clip onto the backs of seats. We broke the students up into groups, and I gave them a problem. And they would work together as a team on the problem, trying to solve it in real time. With me in the room, with the TAs in the room, and we would go from group to group and listen in on the discussions, address questions when they came up, make suggestions, nudge them in the right direction, and the progress accelerated. They seemed to be getting it much more quickly. That worked fine, but it was just a few weeks out of a term. This year, I did something different. It was not easy to do at Caltech. What I wanted was a room that would have tables that I could break the students up into groups and have them really work as teams, that would have white walls that I could use these little projectors that they could project up onto the wall, not sitting in theater seats all facing the same direction, projecting to the side, which they had to do, and we had to turn almost all the lights off because this generation of projectors are not very bright. I did find one room where we could do this, and so in the last four classes, have been conducting the experiment. I scheduled the class for a 2.5-hour session, another thing that's very difficult to do at Caltech. Caltech's set up for lectures. 1 hour Monday, Wednesday, Friday, or hour and a half Tuesday, Thursday. I wanted 2.5 hours. I wanted enough time that I could actually give them a problem and they could make significant progress in the class. I want most of the work in the class where there are people there to address questions immediately, to provide feedback, and to help guide them along. The first class, I gave them a problem to do on their own. turned out that most of the students had a little bit of background. None of them reached some of the key points that I want students to reach by the end, for example, using functions. But most made some progress, but the disparity in the level was very, very large. Then we turned to giving them a problem. I give them readings in advance. I use the Moodle website to post materials to read and make available to them just before the class the problem that they're going to look at on a day, and they attack the problem. The first problem I gave them was one that was an extension of what they had done that first day, and suddenly they were talking to each other and they understood where they'd gotten stuck before. Second one, I gave them a data set that they could not possibly look at without a computer, just 12,000 data points, 45 experiments, that they had to find the experiments in the data and turn them loose in trying to extract basic ideas from that. Some of the notes I gave them were introducing the basic statistical concepts because the students were not demonstrating an ability to use statistics in a practical sense. So now they're using statistics in the class and becoming comfortable with it. So far this year, I've only had four sessions, had one this morning. At each session, they are accelerating their progress. The rate at which they are picking up the concepts seems far faster than what I've seen before. Why? It's because they are interacting with each other. I've taken off all barriers to the collaboration. For the collaborative projects in class, I have them write a joint report. Those reports so far have all captured almost all the points that we had identified in the problems. Now I'm going step by step through these problems, but they're picking up new concepts as we go along. I've also given them some very specific problems that they're to do totally on their own. The first one, I will have to wait another week before I see the results of it, but my expectation is that the level of programming skill that I will see will be far higher than what they had at the first exercise. So, I think the take-home message here is that for some kinds of learning, changing from the standard lecture approach to the more active engagement really can work. We can make progress at really, really very low cost. These projectors are about $200. I'm sure the price is about the same, but I hope that the newer projectors have better lamps in them. At low cost, we can make some substantial progress, but we have to rethink some issues, like how we lay out classrooms. We need classrooms that are available for using in different modes, especially in this kind of group learning mode that requires special kind of space. I'm optimistic about where it's going, but it is, as I say, an experiment in progress.
Thank you, Rick. Let me invite Antonio up to the podium.
Hi, good afternoon. I am very good at following instructions, I'm told. So I will follow the format a little bit that Cassandra established. I want to tell you a little bit where I'm coming from with this and then what we did. So there is a joke in my field that everybody studies whatever they are really bad at. And I've been obsessed with how we make decisions and self-control and things like that my entire career. And I ran a lab in my pre-education days in which we basically study how the brain makes decisions that combines, tools from cognitive neuroscience, behavioral and experimental economics, cognitive modeling, and a lot of statistics and machine learning. And we will worry about questions like this. You know, if I put an apple and an orange in front of you, what exactly are the computations that your brain makes in real time to make those choices? What can go wrong? How does your brain implement and constrain those computations, et cetera? You'll see why I'm telling you this in a second. That's where I came from. And I would say about 5 years ago, there was this explosion in the educational system and in the news about new technologies like MOOCs, massive online open courses, and the possibilities that they open that were both very exciting and extremely overhyped, okay? But I found it very exciting, the idea that, for example, you could open the Caltech classroom and give access to this amazing resource that we have to the thousands and thousands of extra students that we will never be able to educate but could benefit from such resources. I was excited by that. And what I quickly realized was that the ratio of hype to substance was off the charts, but that there was a lot of previous research that had been done that was very promising, that we could not reinvent the wheel, but that there were ideas from psychology, from education, that could be used to potentially realize these technologies. And to me, the transition into this field was based on the following insight, that you could potentially worry about modeling when a student is learning in a different classroom settings, what exactly are the computations that are going on in the brain of that student during the learning process. Use all the kinds of tricks that we used in cognitive neuroscience to try to identify where those mental processes are, and then add to it a layer of learning engineering to try to optimize the learning process. That somehow you could combine the scientific methods that we have been developing and using for years with this passion for promoting learning. And I just want to give you a flavor for why this can be so powerful with a toy example, which is, this is just simulations from a very, very simple model, but that capture the power of being able to model and understand where students are. I'm going to speak loudly and move to the board. So the idea here is to simulate students, each one of these paths is a student, the colors are the average, that have to go through a course, an abstract course, in which you need to learn 100 things, one after the other. And when you learn 100 things, you have learned the course. If there was no noise and the teacher was omniscient, he could present at the ideal pace one thing after the other, and after 100 steps, the student will be perfectly there. He would have learned everything, they will walk out of the class, story ended. The problem is, suppose, this is the very simplistic idea that this is modeling, suppose for a second that you learn a lot. If I give you something at just the right level of difficulty and background that you have acquired so far. But if I give you something too easy, you learn nothing. If I give you something too hard, you learn nothing. Okay? And not only that, suppose, this is not so applicable for on-campus courses, but it matters a lot for online courses, that as you stop learning, you start getting frustrated, you're more likely to give up altogether. Just quit. Okay? So then you can ask, how different methods of teaching affect the effectiveness of teaching and the probability that the students actually complete their course and achieve their goals? This is simulating that. So you could imagine the worst possible scenario in which you have an anti-omniscient teacher that just hands out materials at random to the students, okay? And that does very poorly because very often the materials are too hard or too easy. And you can see that even after a course that is three times longer than necessary, most of the students have not learned and most of them have dropped off. You could imagine the current educational system, which is this simulation here, which is linear. I write a curriculum and say, in day one, you do activity one, in day two, you do activity two, in day three, you do activity three, etc. Okay? And what happens there is that some students do very well. But the problem is that a lot of students are falling behind and they never catch up. So you only saturate, you only achieve, of course, it depends on parameters and things like that, but about, in that particular simulation, about 3/4. And you still lose a lot of people. And the idea was, of course, you're never omniscient. I cannot look at the minds of my students and know exactly what they have understood or not. But in mind that you had a system, for example, in which by looking at faces, by using eye tracking, by measuring response times, by asking questions cleverly, you could get noisy signals at every instant of where they are in the learning process. And then you apply optimal Bayesian algorithms, the same kind of algorithms that guide satellites, that type of logic, to try to infer where the students are, and then you serve them activities and questions to optimize this. You don't get the optimum, but you don't lose students, and now by 150, you have catch everything. Just to give you a flavor of why the power of this, in theory, this is in theory, can work so well. And that's what got me started and excited about all of this. So what we have done so far, for the last 4 years, I've done the what I would consider the baby version of this, designed to try to get some value gains for Caltech students in the short term, and honestly, to educate myself. So I teach a course called EC11, Principles of Economics, that is one of the introductory social sciences courses. And I used to teach it as a lecture, regular thing. And what I decided is to start experimenting. So about 4 years ago, we started teaching in a flipped classroom model. That means the students take sign to an online system like edX. They take all of the lectures, all of the problem sets, the final, and they have a discussion board online. And we like this system because the homeworks can be programmed. There's enough technology in there that you can give Caltech homeworks, not silly multiple choice questions only and things like that. You can really do sophisticated stuff with effort, but you can. And the students, in principle, can do all of the course online. And in fact, about 40% of them never show up to class. And I'm happy for that because a lot of our students don't want to do economics. They want to do something else. And there are course conflicts. And I'd rather take the second class in biology that they need to be able to do their surf than not be able to do it because of this. About 60% of the students take advantage of the second part of the course, which is the flipped classroom. And what happens is, a picture of a flipped classroom last week, is that students are supposed to turn the problem set in this week, this time on Wednesdays, and on Thursday there is an in-class meeting. And in that class meeting, we do a challenge problems, which we give them problems that are based on the previous material but much harder, and they work on teams and compete and we discuss the solutions, et cetera. But most of the work takes place with them interacting and arguing with each other. Okay, very much like you were describing. And because incentives are required, I give them extra credit if they do this. Okay, and this has worked well in many domains, not perfectly. The enrollment has exploded. It was, before we started doing the experiments, it was about 60. The grades have not suffered and have spiked a little, but we haven't done something. I don't have the technology with this system to really do careful tests. So I'm almost done. What are we doing next is, for the last year and a half, I have taken a chunk of my lab, and we're building a platform that tries to provide real learning engineering R&D. And one of the key insights here is that when you change media, for example, from the classroom to online, you lose some things, and you gain a lot of things. You cannot just tape videos and put them online. You have to optimize to the technology. So there is no time now. I won't go through all of the details, but I'm happy to discuss them with anyone who's interested. We are changing the way this online component of the courses is done, and in many, many different ways. Perhaps the two that are more exciting I want to discuss are here, is that we really want to think of teaching as an individualized process in which the goal is to achieve learning, a level of learning for every student with whatever path gets them there as quickly as possible. Not everybody going through a sequence of linear things. That requires, it's expensive because it requires producing a lot more material and having algorithms that help you with that you can convince the students work. That's the hardest part, but it can be done. And the other thing is, there is an enormous literature out there that is really incredibly good. I would say 30 years of research showing that students have terrible mistaken beliefs about learning. And our students are particularly bad at this. For example, they believe that they can do a problem statement once a week and master a subject. So kind of using takes from psychology and behavioral economics to try to get them to do better learning skills. This is the last slide. So we're working like this in Crazy. The goal with this is to kind of, over the years, pursue versions of this vision, which is, I believe that over the next years, we're going to see an explosion of, and a lot of pressure, to bring best practices and good edtech into the classes, even on campus, to improve teaching. And I think the possibilities are endless, although a lot of research has to be done. I believe, and I know this is not shared by many other people, that we need to seriously consider speeding up degrees, because every year of time at Caltech costs the students, by the time you do the numbers, about $250,000. Okay, and yes, what, I mean, this is wonderful, but is $250,000 wonderful? I'm not sure. Okay, and it will be possible, for example, for the students to be a shortened amount of time in campus, do some of the coursework online at levels that are equally good, and then come to campus and really take advantage of the things that are unique. Standing in a classroom, solving problems with their colleagues that are really, really challenging. Doing a SERV, a research seminar on advanced topics in biology. And the final thing, this technology would allow us to really increase access to a lot of populations that will benefit from elite education that have zero access to them. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Antonio. And let's welcome Gregg. Get this started for you. Fantastic.
I'm really impressed at how close to the time we are, and that's a real challenge because now I have 10 minutes to finish up here, and it would be harder if I don't do it. But I want to tell you with this, I know that I have just the 10 minutes, and Cassandra's sitting here with her watch, so I'm going to try to hit that. I want to do four things in my 10 minutes. I want to tell you a little bit of a personal journey that I had starting here at Caltech when I graduated. I graduated in 69. And then a little bit about courage in education, because that experience got me involved in a 30-year experience with looking at courage in education. And then talk a little bit about courage in general, because it's also stimulated that thinking, and about celebrating courage. So those are the four things. This is my start of my journey. This is me at Caltech in 1968. I was doing a student-initiated project. The student government president came to me and said, Ford Foundation will give us money, but if we got to have at least ask for $10,000. What should we do? And of course, the 60s and trying to get Caltech involved in the community, and we said, okay. And so we designed a program that got Caltech faculty and students out into the third grade classes in Pasadena to be a science resource. Wasn't quite what I expected, because the teacher that I first met said, oh, great, we're so glad you're here. I'll be in the student lounge. I'll be back in an hour. First day. But anyway, it was a life-changing experience for me. And by graduation time, after graduation, I actually was to the point of saying, do I want to go to medical school like I've already been planned? Or do I want to go into education? I mean, elementary education, school, these schools were so much more important than I ever thought they were. I'd never been back in one since I was in sixth grade. You might think that's a pretty strange question for a Caltech graduate to be asking, and my dad thought so too. My dad's a lawyer, and we argued about it, and I thought he was just one of those over 30 people who didn't really understand what's really important. But his argument that, Gregg, if you go to medicine and don't like it, you can get into education, but if you go to education and you don't like it, you're probably not getting into medical school. That convinced me. So I actually did go on a let's see if I can do both. So I got my MD after graduating in Cleveland, and they were good enough to give me a year out between second and third year, and I got a master's in elementary education at the University of Massachusetts, not knowing exactly why, but I just thought, when I start third year medical school, the rest of my life is booked up, so I'm not ever going to do it if I don't do it now. I got into pediatrics, and so that was helpful because my specialty became school health and child development. And then I ended up being kind of an ambassador between schools and medicine in terms of dealing with kids with disabilities that were in the 70s. We were finding out that schools had to deal with every child. Then I got into public health, and then in 1986, this happened. Anyone who was over 6 years old in 1986 might know what this is, but this is the explosion of the Challenger space shuttle. And I rode out on the in the airplane coming here with a guy who was 6 years or sixth grade or first grade, 6 years old at that. He remembers it because they showed it in class. But Krista McAuliffe here is on the left. She was a high school social studies teacher from New Hampshire, and she won a nationwide competition. I guess one is in quotes because the prize was to go on the space shuttle Challenger that blew up. But she was going to do the ultimate field trips from space. She did it because she really wanted the country to know how important education was and to be thinking about education. This is the reason that it made a difference to me, because those were my kids about the time of the space shuttle. And the outside tour was in first grade and just before kindergarten. And we spent every morning for that week saying, oh, today the teacher's going to go into space. And then we come home that night and say, oh, it was way too cold in California. They didn't go. So then, you know, a couple days later, oh, today the teacher's going to go. So when it did blow up, I was involved in that particular launch. And it struck me, having worked in schools and in school health and school pediatric, just as an impulse, there ought to be a way to give courageous teachers in Nebraska a prize. So I kind of envisioned this as just an impulse. I had no idea what a courageous teacher was, because I knew they didn't have to go on the space shuttle, but I knew that there were a lot of courageous teachers that I had worked with. So we started a statewide prize for K through 12 teachers, and we have annual nominations for the prize, and then we have a selection committee that's chaired by myself and the dean of the College of Education, and we have people that are both in education and non-education to make a selection. We give a $1,000 prize to the winner, and we now have 30 teachers that have won the Krista McAuliffe Prize for Courage and Excellence in Education. So now we have 30 definitions of what courage in education is, at least at the K through 12 level. I'm going to give you six of them, and the other 24 are just as good. I could use any one of them, I think, because they all could have been Teachers of the Year, but they also each had a courage element in their life. So first of, we learned that courageous teachers stand up for what is right, even if nobody else is there. I used to say everybody else is sitting down, but they're standing up for what is right. And these are three examples. Mike is a small town science teacher. And up the road from him, there was a huge political problem because we're a five-state low-level nuclear waste compact, and they decided that Northeast Nebraska was the best place to put the facility to handle everybody's low-level nuclear waste. Well, half of the county said, great, jobs for everybody, and the other half said, oh no, it's poison for everybody. Turned out it was really an economic thing, because part of the county that won the high school and took the high school away from the other part was the one that was going to get the facility. But they were at each other's throat. There was a New York Times article, a Los Angeles Times article said, you know, this is really happening in Nebraska. It's really, there were, you know, that says dope pusher, dump pusher, same thing. I was the state health director, and the only time I thought I'd get tarred and feathered in my job was when I had to go up there and deal with a community meeting, low level. Well, Mike's principal said, don't go near that. You know, you can't win. But Mike said, I'm teaching about radiation in my science, and I'm going to send them out in the community and have them interview people about why they're worried or what they think or whether is it a good thing or not. And then we'll come back and talk about radiation. And he really, when we called the principal and said, hey, Mike won, the first thing he said was, oh, I wish you hadn't have done that. Because he was kind of a pain for the principal, but he really was a good teacher and got those students. Doris was a journalism teacher, and she was after a principal to, you can't just censor anything you want out of the school newspaper. There's something called the First Amendment. We want to teach our kids about that, about the First Amendment rights. So he said no, but she said, okay, well, she found a state senator to introduce a bill that would protect school newspapers' First Amendment rights. And it didn't pass, but she got her students up to testify about First Amendment. She, you know, and by the time we gave her the prize, she had a teacher that loved her, because she was a great teacher, but she knew that was the right thing to do, and she did it. And then the third one, Brian, science teacher and a wrestling coach, again, small town in the North Loop Valley in Nebraska. And up the road from him, you think Nebraska's always in a political turmoil. Well, kind of is, maybe. But up the road from him, they were wanting to pass a law that said you cannot rent your house to anybody unless they can show you their citizenship papers. Because, you can't read that in the... Because, you know, stop the invasion. Illegal immigrants are invaders to our country. It's treason if you rent your house to them, you know, so don't do it. Luckily, that didn't pass. But at the same time, Brian was really connecting with his dream students. The kids that were brought here as children have lived all the time in Nebraska, were great students, and they couldn't get a driver's license. They couldn't get a scholarship. And one of his students was going to walk 150 miles to the state capitol to make the case for a better state law. And Brian said, I'm walking with you too. And he, you know, really supported those kids in every way in an environment where a lot of people weren't very supportive for those kids. We also learned that courageous teachers sometimes just persistently do what's right, even when it's difficult. Chris Ann was the art teacher at the State Juvenile Delinquent Center, or Juvenile Detention Facility. So she was teaching art to probably the hardest kids to actually connect with art, but she was great at it, and she did it day after day. We thought that was courageous. Calvin was the first male and the first black kindergarten teacher in Lincoln, he just really wanted to be an elementary teacher and took a lot of guff for a lot of discrimination from lots of people for both of those things. But they offered him to get into administration, but no, he wanted to teach those young kids. And he retired from a sixth grade teacher job right soon after we gave him the prize. And Jill had a long career in deaf education, but it started because her first year of teaching, she had kindergarten class, and they said, oh, by the way, one of your kids can't hear. We don't have any special program for these kids, but the parents wanted the kid in school, so you've got them. She really took the challenge, and her whole career was, you know, what do we do with these kids? And by the time she retired, she really had influence education for hearing impaired children all across the state. Those two kinds of things were courage for us. They stood up when nobody else was, or they just kept at a really difficult part of the work. So what is courage? A couple points about courage in general. First, it's a value-laden thing. You can't look at it without the value judgments being involved. And of course, the ancient Greeks thought it was one of the four virtues. In fact, many people said it's the most important virtue because you have to be courageous if you're going to do any of the other virtues. And so the definitions in the dictionary don't acknowledge that. They say it's the ability to act even if you're afraid or even if it's hard. That's the dictionary. They stop at that. Almost everybody that studies it says, no, you got to go further than that. You have to do what is right in the face of fear, or you have to do what is for a noble purpose in the face of fear or adversity. And I certainly have come to believe that if you rob a bank or jump off a mountain for your, you know, for your pocketbook or your adrenaline addiction, I don't think it's courageous. But if you do things that where you're putting your life or your well-being at risk because of something for the greater good. So if it's value-laden, we're not ever going to agree on what's courage exactly unless we have shared common values. If you bomb a building or if you drop bombs on a building, it's going to depend on why you're doing it, whether you think that was courage or not. And I don't want to equate these two things in any way except to say the value of what's happening influences whether people say it's courage or not courage, and you can't get away from that. Third thing is just to look a little bit about what is it we fear. I've been asking people all over the place ever since I kind of got interested in looking at this, you know, who's a courageous person? And the first thing people think of is, well, soldiers or firefighters. And it's the fear of death. And that's what the ancient Greeks thought, too. If you're willing to stay in a hand-to-hand battle, then you're courageous. And if you run away, then you're not. But none of our teachers were fear of their life. But they were fear of disconnection from their connectedness. Status in the community, they might lose that. They might lose the respect of people who say they're wrong. They might lose their job or their ability to provide for some, or just risk failure. Those are all things that people are afraid of, and that's what courage in education kind of brings out. Both of those fears are deeply embedded in our brain. Fear of death, of course, is just the flight or flight reflex that we have, you know, protect ourselves. But fear of disconnection, we're heavily wired to connect with other human beings, and we're very afraid if we're missing that connection. Fourth thing about courage and competence interact in an interesting way. Courage is required to become competent. If you think about it, you risk failure, you're ready to risk looking dumb, you're going to try scary things, you're going to question authority, you're going to work persistently. If you do that, you'll become competent. If you're too timid, you could never be competent. So that's another way to kind of look at it. But on the other hand, once you're competent, that changes the nature of courage. You have a much better accurate idea of what the fears are. You have fewer unknowns. Everyone's afraid of the unknown, but the more you know, the less you have unknown. But you have more options, you have more effective action, and you can avoid missteps. So people might think you're really courageous and you're just smart enough about the field to say, no, that wasn't even a risk. That was just the thing to do. Courage and crazy have an interaction. Sometimes courageous people look crazy or have to be willing to look crazy. This is an example from science. Dan Schuckman, who's a faculty member from Israel and Iowa, and he, in 1982, said he discovered a new kind of crystal, and everyone said he's crazy. And the APS put him in the crackpot section and had to give his talks along with the people with the tinfoil hats and everything. But then sometimes crazy people turn to be courageous because he won the Nobel Prize in 2011 for his ideas on crystal. So, and then last is, you can't get away, besides being value-laden, it's going to require judgment. We can't measure fear very well. We can't measure adversity, what that person was worried about. We can't measure noble cause because it's a social thing. So the last thing I think I've learned from this is, there's four reasons why it's a good thing to celebrate courage like we've been doing. One is the one I started with. Gee, if they did something good, we ought to recognize them. That's courage, especially if they don't die in the space shuttle. But second, it's really good to recognize that act as something that's noble and worth doing. We said it's really okay not to get along with your principal all the time, and the dean of education on the committee was part of the, you know, that's a public statement about how to be a good teacher in Nebraska. Courage is contagious. A lot of people say that, and I'm from when I get in public health, more of an infectious disease kind of epidemiology look. But if you're going to be more courageous, if you know courageous people who you identify with, it is. And so that's a good reason to recognize courage, is to recognize a model. And then finally, the discussion of the body of people to say this is courage publicly sets public values, so we can be courageous. Any of these people could be nominated for that, and doing so would be a really good thing.
Thank you so much. So I know that through these interesting and really different presentations, I'm sure that you have some questions and some thoughts that we'd like to explore. I hope that you noticed that everyone thought either their presentation was going to be the beyond or the not, but that really all of them were both, were deeply situated in their experiences at Caltech and also took us somewhere else. So what questions might you have? Does anyone like to hear about anything more that a speaker talked about, or like to connect the ideas up a little bit? Yes. Yep.
So, question for Pamela Bjorkman. What motivated you to go and teach monks? science?
So why did I want to do this? One reason was that I'd been teaching Bi-1, which is the freshman course in biology for the non-majors, so it's part of the core curriculum. And that was extremely challenging to teach the non-majors. The fundamentals I felt that someone who was not going to major in biology needed to know in order to live in today's world, like to be competent to interpret your blood test or make medical decisions or vote on should you use stem cells in research, what's a genetically modified organism, and should I care about this. And I thought that today people need to know this. And in teaching Bi-1, which I did for 5 years, I really struggled to get students enthusiastic at Caltech. And then fast forward 4 or 5 years after I stopped teaching Bi-1, I heard about this teaching monks. And I just thought, this is really interesting, because now you've got a different population. They actually are more eager to take this class than I think the Caltech students are. But their background isn't as good. It really isn't as good. And so could I learn something through teaching a different set of people that would motivate how science education should be done in the US? And I'm also just interested in concepts of Buddhism, and I wanted to see how these people lived and what they thought. So I learned a huge amount from them, just from their philosophy of life. I mean, I always feel like I learned more from them than they learned from me. But what I think the interesting combination here is that these students were so enthusiastic about learning. And I think there must be a way to bring this to American students as well. And so I was hoping that through the way we were teaching them was more activity-based. And if we could bring this into some of the courses at Caltech, where there's more hands-on learning and not just sitting there and listening to the professor, there might be more enthusiasm for this. So what I'm really hoping is we could encourage Caltech students to use what they learn in some of these basic undergraduate, you know, Bi-1's a very basic class, but maybe they could go out into the community and then deliver what they know in elementary schools, junior highs, and places like that.
Thanks for that. The monks look like they had a lot of fun learning. But do you think they had fun because they just enjoyed social interaction with each other that they normally have in a different way? Or because they really enjoyed the knowledge? And did you follow up and see how well they learned the information that you taught?
Well, I'll answer the last part first. We did have a final at the end of the class. So, and the final, because there was 110 of them, had to be multiple choice, which I don't like multiple choice tests. But there was a range of scores, and some of them understood a lot. I was surprised. Some of them asked questions through the interpreter that indicated they were really thinking. So it's hard for me to say if they enjoyed it because they just enjoyed interacting with each other. But these people are kind of self-selected. They're interested in learning to begin with. But given the language barrier, I couldn't interact directly with most of the students. I was interacting through an interpreter with them.
Pamela, you said something that reminded me of my Caltech experience, because one of the biology professors was out in our third grade program too, and I remember vividly, it was Bill Wood, and he came back and said, what happens to people between third grade and the freshman biology, because these kids were so excited and asking so much questions, and they just described it like you did.
Yeah. Well, indeed, what you experienced as an undergraduate here, so that would help us come full circle. Other questions, comments?
So I have a question. This is directed at all four of you, no one in particular. So many of your education styles, I noticed, touch on the importance of socializing, both, you know, between teacher and student and between the students themselves. But Gregg raised an interesting point about courage, and I noticed that a lot of the students I've had in my classes are shy or are socially anxious. So how do you reach out to those students? Do you have any kind of commentary on how we reach those students?
I can tell you first an anecdote and then a more general comment. So when I do these flipped classroom sessions, what happens is the following. The students come, they know what the topic is for the class. I hand them a worded problem with multiple parts, and they are supposed to work on the first part for about 15 minutes on their own. At some point I say, okay, now match with someone, discuss for about 10 minutes, you can change the answer, try to convince each other about what the right answer is. And these are hard problems, so they often flip back and forth. And then you commit on an answer, and that's what you get your extra credit from, and then we discuss, okay? And initially I used to use all sorts of crazy randomization devices with the idea that it would be good for them to be exposed to people from different houses here, or different genders, or different ethnicities, et cetera. And I had a lot of students email me saying, please don't do that, it's painful for us. Okay, literally your comment. And what we decided to do is, this is trial by error. You know, you keep trying, you keep fine tuning for your particular population. Now we made the announcements that you can pair with whoever you want. It can be the same group for the entire class. And in fact, when you arrive, you sit next to whoever you want to talk to. And has this improved learning? I don't have a measure, but I can tell you that it has increased attendance to these flipped classrooms by about 20%. So there are things you can do. One other comment on that is that, you know, I have some libertarian streaks within me, and I feel always very hesitant to impose things on people unless there is a lot of evidence that these things can help. But I think that, to me, of reading the educational literature, one of the most important lessons is that students have no clue what's good for them in terms of learning as a group. They have really bad models. So I wonder, for example, if some forced experimentation with these kinds of things, except for extreme cases psychologically, and we have a lot of them here, can really help. That people will find it's not as bad as they think and they actually enjoy it. But again, my advice is to experiment with your population, collect whatever data you can and fine tune based on that. Yeah.
I had success through, or at least what felt like success through most of my teaching career for something that I actually developed with the third graders. And that was, I start off many classes by saying, let's just list the questions you have about this. We're talking now about addiction and methamphetamine. What questions do you have about this? And if you write 5 or 6 or 7 questions down and you don't answer them, you just say, good question, now what? It became apparent to me that some of the shy ones just were afraid that they couldn't figure a question that's good enough to take the whole class to listen to it and not a dumb question. And then once they see that you're just listening and you're not focusing on them, you get so much information about what language they use, how they're thinking, what, you know, and then when you teach them, you're kind of going right to the way they're thinking. What was that?
When I'm trying to teach kids how to program. I have a class where I've got people who are really masters at the language at a reasonably high level when they walk in the door, and students who know very little. When I tried to do it as a lecture course, there was always one of that first group of students who would answer or try to answer any question. Always had a suggestion, and everyone else was intimidated. When I've been breaking them up into small groups and having them work together, they're interacting at a much, much more intense level. The volume in the room sometimes gets pretty loud. You do see a student or two who will sort of withdraw a little bit from the group, but they're still there, they're still listening in, and they still get pulled in from time to time. I don't see any way to get them fully engaged the full time, but I see the level of involvement when it's a small group, not the big group, when the stigma of collaboration has been removed, when they're you know, fully engaged in trying to solve a problem together. Someone gets stuck, another one in the group has a suggestion, and they'll take it and run.
Thank you. How about one more question, if you have one? Anyone? All right. Well, thanks to our panelists one more time, and thank you all for coming.